3, 2, 1.
Right, welcome back to my channel. Just got back from dropping of application at a hotel called Double Tree Hotel. And I got some donuts. Blessed. Look at those donuts. Jesus is good. That's my little boo. Say hi, boo. Hi, boo. She's so cute. And my other little boo's up there. That's Mr. Baby Blue. He's talking right now. And that's my other little boo right there. Her name is Miss Yellow Belly. Hi, Belly. Hi, Yellow Belly. Say hi. Yeah, hi. All right. Let's go to my YouTube channel. So I can show you where you can subscribe. The Watchmen, Events, End Time. We're close to the end time. Library. My videos, when I went to SoCal Harvest. Good. Don't miss the last Bible Buzz. Tonight's gonna be Bible Buzz part 27. And I think it might end the series. Alright, that's it. That's that. One thing before I go. Don't miss it tonight. Bible Bus, download the series. Yes, and I'll be back in my church this Sunday. Alright, and we pray that this whole world changes. They're forging the shots, man. Did you hear about the vaccine card? If you don't have it, man, you can't get in. What? Alright.
How you doing
everybody? Welcome back. Welcome to my channel. I hope everybody had a blessed week. This is Bible Buzz part 27. Still in Exodus, we believe. Yes. I think on chapter 31, verse 1, versus something else. But I'll put it below verse of the day 2. Actually, let me check the verse of the day. You know, I might even say it. There's still time. It starts at 8 exactly, anyways. So. The verse of the day is John 15:12. This is my commandment, love each other in the same way I have loved you, like what he did on the cross. That's. What verse is that? That's John 15, verse 12. Okay, I'll put that verse too. I'm back with the verses, yes. Alright, we pray. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we pray right now for allergies, for my sister's anger, for the pets, the neighbors, they find you, Lord, the whole world finds you, Lord, and stop saying, hey, I don't need Jesus, they do need you. And people get saved with this. In Jesus' name we pray that people get saved with Bible Buzz and any other church that has Bible doctrine. Baptism, remember. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Alright, logging out. Hold on, check it out. Watch. Check it out. Logging out.
Because you know I don't love it. Woo! Hey, now you know. Inhale, exhale with my flow. One for the money, two for the...
He slips a tackle as he crosses the line of scrimmage and gets midfield. Michael Hoyt. Now I find just when
the air goes, I got a feeling. Mm-hmm.
is the gift I need. You're faithful, faithful in all things. In every high, in every low, on mountaintops, down broken roads, you're still my rock, my hope remains. I rest in the arms of Jesus, come what may. That you give to me, what hurt needs the healing, is a holy thing. I see goodness, your goodness in all things, yeah. In every high, in every low, on mountaintops, down broken roads, you're still shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. The Lord is my shepherd, leads me to still waters, and He restores my soul.
He restores my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures.
Is We Are Messengers, all the way from Ireland, that band. I'm positive, encouraging, K-Love. Hi there, I'm Alex, finishing off the week strong. Of course, tomorrow, Friday. And maybe you are counting down the hours until you get to frolic off into the weekend, doing some fun fall activities. Or maybe you're just trying to get some sleep. Get to sleep in. Because we all know what happens when you don't get enough sleep. Things can get weird. It's true. Got Sarah here on the line with us. What happened?
My daughter was born. She had to be in the NICU for 2 days. I was awake for probably 2 straight days. So we brought her home, and I slept for probably an hour. The doctor called to check on us just to see, you know, how are you guys doing and settling in. And I was exhausted, and I am so used to talking to my family on the phone and hanging up with them that when I went to hang up with the doctor, she said, "You have a great night." And I said, "Yeah, you too. Okay, love you." She goes, "Well, thanks."
Awkward. What did you say after that?
I said, "Oh my gosh." I said, "I'm so sorry." She goes, "No, it's nice to hear." At least I didn't say it to somebody I didn't like.
K-Love, 1 minute of encouragement. Judd Wilhite.
Have you ever poured yourself a glass of expired milk? It's not fun. But did you know that sunscreen goes bad too? It should be tossed after a year. Ditch your mascara after 3 months. And that open bottle of spaghetti sauce in the fridge grows mold 4 days after you open it. Yikes. Well, a lot of things come with an expiration date, but forgiveness isn't one of them. Ephesians 1 says, "Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, we're a free people, free of penalties and punishments chalked up by all our misdeeds. And not just barely free either, abundantly free." God's love doesn't expire. No matter your past, God's forgiveness still covers you, and His grace still empowers you. Even when you go bad, God's faithful love never will. His mercies are guaranteed fresh every morning.
Connect with Judd Wilhite at klove.com. Keyword, encouragement.
We want our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. But for the hurting in our city, would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see a change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. Lord, it's got to start right here. Lord, it's got to start right now. I'm like the brother of the prodigal, turned his nose and puffed his chest. He didn't run off like his brother, but his soul was just as dead. What if the church on Sunday was still the church on Monday too? What if we came down from our towers and walked a mile in someone's shoes? 'Cause we wanna see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see a change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. Lord, start right here. Lord, start right now. We're the people who are called by His name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land, but it starts right here. We're the people who are called by His name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now.
Positive, encouraging music.
I knew I was broken, but there was no one that I could tell. Praying felt like I was throwing pennies in a wishing well.
It's Satan's attacks. John, today you painted a vivid picture of just how real the battle is and how clever Satan is in his attempts to attack us and derail us. We're up against a formidable enemy. But what you said that caught my ear, and it's encouraging, is that Satan will flee if you know what to do, if you resist him. So talk about that.
Yeah, the Bible couldn't be more explicit. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. So the question is, how do you resist? Look, if you just take that one statement, resist the devil and he will flee from you, the immediate question should be, okay, how do I resist, right?
Yeah.
Because I want the devil to flee.
Luther threw an ink pot at him.
Yeah, I don't think that was very effective. But so if the Bible says resist the devil and he'll flee from you, I want to know how to resist the devil. And the answer to that is the believer's armor. That's how you resist the devil. You're armed to resist. And that's what we're learning in this incredibly foundational and essential series on the believer's armor. And I just remind you that we have produced a study guide that goes with this lengthy series. If you don't have a copy of the Believer's Armor Study Guide, it's reasonably priced. It's a 200-page paperback book that goes along with every day's radio broadcast. So you're following an outline, and it's consistent with what you're hearing. It'll enrich your learning experience. We used to do this way back in the 80s, and we're relaunching the study guides. We would love to get you started in using them because they really intensify your learning experience. You, of course, know you can order one from Grace to You.
Yes, you can. And friend, the armor God provides is foundational to living a life that glorifies our Lord, overcomes sin, and fights off discouragement. So I encourage you to get this study guide and take a deep look at each piece of the armor and find out how that can equip you to deal with any spiritual attack. To pick up our new Believer's Armor Study Guide, contact us today. You can place your order at our website, gty.org, or call us at 800-55-GRACE. The Believer's Armor Study Guide costs $11 and shipping is free. It's a great resource for personal devotions and group studies. Again, to get a copy for yourself or for a friend, call 800-55-GRACE or go to gty.org. Also, if you're benefiting from these lessons, know that's what's happening across the globe. People are growing spiritually because men and women like you support us financially. We're able to reach pastors, Sunday school teachers, business people, stay-at-home moms, college students, and many others. You help make that ministry possible when you give. To make a tax-deductible donation, write to us at Grace to You, Box 4000, Panorama City, California, 91412, or call us at 800-55-GRACE or go to our website gty.org. That's gty.org. And now for John MacArthur and the entire Grace to You staff, I'm Phil Johnson. Thanks for making this broadcast part of your day, and be here tomorrow when John looks at how you can stand strong even against the worst of Satan's attacks. Join us for the next 30 minutes of Unleashing God's Truth, one verse at a time, on Grace to You.
That was sponsored by Grace to You on 99.5 KKLA. You know, there are certain things in life that it feels like as you get older, you just know, like how to fold a fitted sheet. Hey, I'm Katie Evans. I still haven't quite figured it out. I've watched so many YouTube videos. My grandma has shown me so many times, and yet when it comes down to do it, it's just like, never ends up just right. So I just kind of, you know, do the best I can, then kind of roll it up and stick it in a pillow sheet. So at least I know where it is. did I say pillow sheet? I meant pillowcase. Anyway, you know how, and you want to give me some tips and tricks on how to fold fitted sheets, that would be great. Or does any other life hacks that you think that you have learned as you have gotten more mature and progressed in age? You can email me at katie@kkla.com or call, leave me a voicemail. Maybe I'll put you on air. Everyone can learn from your expertise. 818-662-3775.
Uplifting, hopeful. Southern California's 99.5 KKLA.
This is Jerry Boyer of Town Hall Finance for townhall.com. It didn't take long for Democrats to start pushing tax hikes on businesses, top brackets, and investors. But wait, isn't this the same crowd which has been pushing modern monetary theory, the magical incantation which promises government never has to raise taxes, that it can just borrow and spend and force the Fed to do the lending? Of course, anyone with a basic understanding of economic realities knows that was wrong all along. Now we know that it was also a lie. It was an excuse to go into permanent hyperspending mode. Now that the dollar is falling in value and trips to the grocery store are becoming a game of how high can it go, the left has pivoted to what they wanted to do all along. Class envy and soak the rich tax policy. The skyrocketing spending, the high taxes, and fast rising inflation are all bad for everyday Americans. The 22 midterm elections can't come soon enough. I'm Jerry Boyer.
Publicpolicy.pepperdine.edu Find yourself turning on the news and feeling hopeless? Open borders, spending on crazy, more mandates, lockdowns, inflation, on and on. There is something you can do. Buy from companies that believe what you and I believe. We need to stick together now more than ever. And there's been a company willing to stand with you since 2012. Patriot Mobile is America's only Christian conservative cell phone provider. They offer broad nationwide coverage using the same towers as all the major carriers. Patriot has plans to fit any budget, and their 100% US-based team provides exceptional customer support. More importantly, Patriot Mobile shares your values and supports organizations fighting for religious freedom, your constitutional rights, sanctity of life, and our veterans and first responder heroes. Go to patriotmobile.com/GORKA or call 972-PATRIOT. Get free activation with the offer code GORKA. Always special discounts for veterans and first responders and for multi-line accounts. Support a company that loves America. patriotmobile.com/GORKA 972-PATRIOT.
I'm Alan Jackson, and I have the privilege of joining you each day to open the Word of God and ask for His input. And I'm convinced the challenges we face in today's world are more spiritual than they are political or economic. Exploring God's Word together is refreshing. It equips us for everything that comes our way. Join me, and let's see what God has in store for us today.
Tune in to Alan Jackson Ministries for a fresh look at Scripture. Weekdays at 1:30 p.m. here on 99.5 KKLA.
A home is a place where I can go knowing that I'm safe.
Hey everyone, this is Mike.
And this is Brian with Fellowship Home Loans.
We wanted you to meet a few friends of Fellowship.
We're contacted by Fellowship Home Loans that we were pre-approved. And he, you know, we had mentioned that my husband was a veteran. And he's like, oh, you have more opportunity.
Brian, our loan officer at Fellowship, made us feel like he wanted us to make the right decision for us, not for what was going to benefit his company.
Let your voice be heard. If you're thinking of a new home or refinance,
Fellowship Home Loans would appreciate the chance to serve.
Give us a call at 800-804-SAVE. That's 800-804-7283. Or online at fellowshiphomeloans.com.
At Fellowship Home Loans, we promise to listen, not sell.
That's 800-804-SAVE.
Or fellowshiphomeloans.com. Welcome home. Intercontinental Capital Group, DBA, Fellowship Home Loans, Equal Housing Opportunity Lender, MLS number 60134.
Listen on Odyssey. KKLA FM Los Angeles. Find hope here.
This is Through the Bible, and it's pre-recorded and sponsored by Through the Bible Radio Network on 99.5 KKLA.
Travel through the whole Word of God in 5 years. One of the things that we often study are the prayers of the Bible. You know, the prayers of Abraham, David, Jesus, and Paul. They all teach us something about how we too can pray. Welcome to Through the Bible. I'm your host, Steve Schwetz, and today our teacher, Dr. J. Vernon McGee, takes us to Exodus for what he calls one of the greatest lessons on prayer that you'll find in the Bible. In fact, through his prayer in Exodus chapter 32, Moses is said to have laid hold of the heart of God and moved the arm of God. In other words, Moses' prayer for the Israelites changed God's mind. Wow, that's got to be one great prayer. So let's not wait any longer. Join me as we pray for our study and dive right in. Heavenly Father, would you show us more about how we can touch your heart and then move your mighty hand to bring us grace and mercy? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's Through the Bible with Dr. J. Vernon McGee.
Now, our study today seems to be a departure from the tabernacle, but actually it is not. What we have before us today is the fact that the interval of the giving of the law and the instructions for the tabernacle, Moses spent a great deal of time up there in the mount getting all these instructions, and the children of Israel became a little impatient down there. And we're going to see what happened in the broken law. But in chapter 31, we have the workmen who built the tabernacle, and one in particular who was given a special gift for making the articles of furniture, that is, those that were the most difficult to make. Now I'm reading, beginning with chapter 31 at verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, See, I have called by name Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship to devise cunning works, to work in gold and in silver and in brass and in cutting of stones, to set them and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. And I, behold, I have given with him, and now you have the list of those that worked with him. And this man, we find out, he made certain things very definitely, and he also made the garments, he and his helpers. Now they were given a special gift for doing this. The Spirit of God equipped them for it. Now the question might arise whether Bezalel was an artisan or artificer before. I'm of the opinion that he was. This man was one who worked with the gold and with the silver and with all of these other delicate things. Now, to do this thing for God, he was given a special gift for it. My feeling is that whatever man's equipped to do, that is the thing that he should do, unless God makes it clear to him to do otherwise. In other words, I think that there are a great many people today that are equipped to do certain things that are technical, that are needed in the Lord's work. Now, I find that there are those that cannot speak, and yet they want to speak. I know quite a few laymen that just determine that they are going to be speakers. They're not equipped for it. They do not have even the semblance of a gift, and yet they will do that, and yet these men have remarkable gifts in other connection. Now, I know a man in radio today. He's a technical expert, but he wants to speak. Well, the fact of the matter is, he has a special gift, I think, for radio. Well, I don't think that he ought to be speaking. I think that he ought to confine himself to the gift that God has given him. And I believe that in the church today, that there are all sorts of things that need to be done, that God gives a special gift for. I remember when I was pastor in Nashville, I had a deacon in a church. He came to me the very first day I was there, and this man had known me from the time I was a boy. And he said to me, "Vernon, don't ever call on me to lead in prayer." He said, "I absolutely am frightened to death. I don't know actually what to say. I have a stage fright that," he said, "it must be abnormal. I just can't overcome it." And he said, "I make a fool of myself when I try to speak in public." Now, this man was an executive. The fact of the matter is, he was superintendent of the streetcar company and had charge of their entire equipment. And that was certainly a place of responsibility. But he told me this. He said, "Now look, I can't do anything publicly, but if there's anything that you want done around this church or you want done personally, you let me know, and I'll be glad to do it." And very candidly, I never had a more wonderful helper than that man was. I would call him many times, even on Saturday night. Now, the streetcar company, see, operated all night. He had a crew down there. And I've called him Saturday night to tell him, "Well, something's come up about Sunday, and we need this for Sunday. For instance, the putting up of a screen, or the different arrangement, or the putting in of chairs." All I had to do is call him, and he'd have a crew out there in less than an hour. And I never had anyone that was such a helper as he is. And you know what? Before I left that church, I was thanking God that he did not have the gift to speak in public, because it made him faithful at the gift that God had given him. Now, here's a man, Bezalel. I'm of the opinion he could have been very much like some layman today. He could have said, "Now, look here, Lord, I want to wear these high priestly garments like Aaron, and I want to serve you like that." But God says, "That's not the way you serve me." And in one sense, his gift is more important than that of Aaron. His gift is one that was essential for the building of the tabernacle. And I think God will give you a gift, friends, that will develop whatever talent you might have or gift you might have. You see, God gives us talents, but he wants us then to dedicate them to the Lord and let the Spirit of God take us and use us. And that doesn't mean we are all to do the same thing. There is a wrong impression today that in the church, if you can't sing in the choir or teach a Sunday school class or speak publicly or be an usher, that you're pretty much out of it. There's nothing left for you to do. And I think there are literally hundreds of gifts that God gives to man to serve today. And it's up to the individual to determine, find out what that gift is. And it may be whatever God's given you as a talent that he'd like for the Spirit of God to take it and use it for his service. Now, we have something else in this chapter that is of profound interest, and it's very important to see. And it has to do with this matter of the Sabbath day. And this is something that a great many people pass over. Now, the Sabbath day was given at the very beginning, I take it after creation, that it was observed universally. Because man, having come from the hand of God as his creator, and having been given the Genesis account, I'm of the opinion that the creation account was universally known by mankind, and it was perverted and changed. Now, this matter of the Sabbath day, though, when you come to the Mosaic system, you find out God made it one of the commandments for the children of Israel. And now he makes it very clear that it was just for the children of Israel. Verse 12 now of chapter 31, and I'm reading, and I want you to listen very carefully. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, Verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Now he said it once to the children of Israel, My Sabbaths, it's a sign between me and you throughout your generations. Now the Sabbath is given now specifically to the children of Israel. And I take it was not given to other people. I do not think it's given to the church at all. When anybody says to me, and every now and then someone likes to pull this type of an approach, they say, when was the Sabbath day changed? Friends, it never was changed. It was done away with as far as we're concerned. We are not under the Sabbath day. That's Saturday, and we don't observe Saturday. That's the day Jesus was dead. We're not serving a dead Christ. The first day of the week he came back from the dead, and the church from the very beginning met on the first day of the week. That's when the church was born, was on the first day of the week. The day of Pentecost was on the day after the Sabbath. It was 50 days, you see. Pentecost means 50, and that very name itself puts it on a Sunday, not on a Saturday. And therefore, today we don't observe it, not because it's been changed. It hasn't been. It was given to the children of Israel, specifically to them. It started off with the whole human race, but man got away from God, and as he did, then God gives it specifically to the children of Israel. I'm not through. Let me read verse 14 here. Ye shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, for it's holy unto you. Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death. And I'd like to know from these people who say you're to keep the Sabbath day, if they keep it all the time, and those of their number who do not keep it, do they put them to death? That's part of it, you see. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. That's very specific, you can see. And very strong, very strict. Verse 15, I'm still reading, friends. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whoso ever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. And the man was gathering sticks, and he stoned him in Israel. Now, verse 16, wherefore the children of Israel, who's he said? The church? No. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Now they are an earthly people belonging to the first creation. The church is a new creation, and it has a new day, and that new day is the first day of the week. Now, in chapter 32, again, we are coming to something that is tragic as far as the children of Israel was concerned, and yet here we see one of the greatest teachings and revelations concerning our God, and also one of the greatest lessons on prayer that you'll find in the Bible. Moses was a great man of prayer, by the way. Now, I'll get into the chapter. Chapter 32, verse 1. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not, or we know not what's become of him. They thought Moses had gone, or that probably been killed, or something had happened to Moses. And now they want to make gods, idols, to lead them along the wilderness march. They were ready to go into idolatry, you see. These people lapsed into it almost immediately. Now notice what happened. You'd think Aaron now would keep them from going into idolatry. No, Aaron did not. Aaron went right along with the liberalism of the people of wanting to return to idolatry. Verse 2, And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And did you know those earrings in that day were a sign of idolatry? It was a sign these people were serving the gods of Egypt. That's what the earrings meant. Now they'd bring these earrings, and all the people break off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand. And notice what it says. And Aaron is in on this, friends, and he fashioned it with a graving tool after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Now, can you imagine these people lapsing into apostasy this quickly? Well, it would be amazing to me if it wasn't for the fact that I live in the day that I live in, and I've seen the church lapse into an apostasy that I never dreamed that I'd live to see it, and yet I knew it was going to come someday. Now, notice what happens here. And they rose up early on the morrow, offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and to drink, and they rose up to play, which means it was gross immorality. They already have departed from God. They said, All his commandments we'll keep, while they are not keeping any of them. Now will you notice verse 7? Now Moses is on the mount getting the law and the instructions, blueprint for the tabernacle. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go, get thee down, for thy people which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They've turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And the Lord said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it's a stiff-necked people. God didn't redeem them, friends, because they were superior, or great, or good. They were none of these. God says, I knew you were a stiff-necked people. Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I will make of thee a great nation. That was a real temptation to Moses. God says, Now Moses, I'll use you like I did Abraham, and make of you a great nation, and I'll still be able to make my covenant good with Abraham. Now notice what Moses does. Here is an example one of the greatest prayers in Scripture. Will you look at it now with me for just a moment? And Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why doth thy wrath wax hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Now God said to Moses, you remember, God says, Moses, get thee down for thy people, that thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt. Now Moses really talks back to God. There's none of this pious cant and this pious piffle that I hear today in a great many fundamentalist prayers. I think that there's more hypocrisy today in some of our prayers. No wonder prayer meetings are so dead. If we talked honestly and frankly to God, it would make one of the most exciting meetings in the church. God says to Moses, your people that you brought out of the land of Egypt, they've sinned. Moses said, Lord, I think you made a mistake. I don't recall of ever bringing any people out of Egypt, and I want you to know they're not my people. Listen to what he says. They're thy people. Thou hast brought them out of the land of Egypt, and you did it with a mighty hand. I couldn't bring them out. You made a mistake, Lord. Can you imagine anybody talking to God like that? Moses did. He said, Lord, they're your people. They're not my people, and you brought them out. I didn't bring them out. Now, that's the first thing he says. Listen to him, the second thing. Wherefore should the Egyptians speak and say, for mischief did he bring them out to slay them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth. Turn from thy fierce wrath and repent of this evil against thy people. Now, what Moses says is this. Lord, they're your people. You brought them out of the land of Egypt. But also, suppose that you don't go through with taking them into the land. Why, the Egyptians will say, well, their God was able to take them out of Egypt, but he wasn't able to bring them into the land. Therefore, you'll have to bring them into the land. They're your people, and you promised to bring them in. Now notice the third reason he gives to God. He says, remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou swearest by thine own self, and saidest unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto your seed, and they will inherit it forever. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Lord, you made a promise to them that you'd do this, and that's the way you remember he called Moses. He said, I remember my covenant. Now, Moses just calls his attention to it again. Now notice, and the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. I tell you, that moved the arm of God, friends, when Moses prayed like that. I think if we were a little more honest in our praying to God, that we'd see more answers, that is, more visible answers. I think we always get an answer. I think the Lord tells most of us no, because we're not really praying honestly to him. Now notice what this man Moses does. Now you'd think he'd come down now and soft soap the children of Israel? No, sir. Listen to him. Moses turned, went down from the mountain. The two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides, and on one side and on the other were they written. And the tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God graven upon the tables. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there is a noise of war in the camp. Believe me, it was. And he said, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither it is the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. Oh, they were having a high old time, friends, down there worshiping this golden calf and living in sin. Came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp that he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and break them beneath the mount, and he took the calf which they had made and burned it in the fire, ground it to powder, and strawed it upon the water, and made the children of Israel drink of it. And believe me, that was bitter. And Moses said unto Aaron, what did this people under thee that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them? And listen now to Aaron crawfish out of all of it. This is really humorous, would be if it wasn't so serious. And Aaron said, let not the anger of my Lord wax hot. Thou knowest the people that they are set on mischief, for they said unto me, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we know not what's become of him. In other words, they're blaming it on Moses, actually. Moses has deserted us, so we'll turn to the golden calf. Now, verse 24, listen to this. And I said unto them, whosoever hath any gold, let them break it off. So they gave it me. Then I cast it into the fire. Listen to this, friends. And there came out this calf. You can't help but laugh at that. And I think Moses actually must have laughed. He says, you don't mean Aaron that you poured the gold in the fire and this calf walked out. That's what he's trying to say. But you remember, it said back over here that he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool. I think Aaron lied, don't you, friend? Oh, what excuse he made here. This man did this, and now I tell you, and when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked under their shame among their enemies. This matter of nudism, friends, and sex today, and dope, is not new. I think you'll look at these people, you'll see the whole bit right here. And now we're going to see Moses, though, and I tell you, he's angry. But did you notice what an intercessor he was for these people? How he laid hold of the heart of God that moved the hand of God. And now we're going to see he's still got a prayer to pray to God for these people. And we'll have to wait till next time to see that. So until then, may God bless you, my beloved.
God hears us. He really listens. If you'd like to join us as we pray and try to lay hold of the heart of God and move His mighty arm to change hearts and lives all over the world, then you need to join our world prayer team at ttb.org/pray. And if you'd like to share the love of God with your family members and friends, visit our website at ttb.org, where you'll find many helpful resources, including a link to download our new app that has the Bible and Dr. McGee's teaching in more than 95 languages. Don't let location or language be a barrier when you want to share God's Word. Check out all the resources yourself at ttb.org or call us at 1-800-65-BIBLE and we'll be happy to help you out. And if you'd like to be in touch by mail, write to Box 7100, Pasadena, California, 91109. In Canada, Box 25325, London, Ontario, N6C, 6B1. There's more to come in this great story from Exodus, so hop aboard the Bible bus next time. I'm Steve Schwetz, and I'll be here saving a seat just for you.
3, 2, 1.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
One thing before I go. Don't miss it tonight. Bible bus. Download the series. Yes, and I'll be back at my church this soon. All right, and we pray that this whole world changes. They're forcing the shots, man. Did you hear about the vaccine card? If you went, you can't get in. What? All right.
Good. Thank you for joining Jesus and me at the Bible bus. Today was Exodus 31 verse 1, then I'll put the rest, and then I'll be back next week. I don't know if he's going to be done with Exodus soon. I think he said he was going to go to Numbers or after, I'm not sure. The program, Dr. McGee, he was in heaven, it's pre-recorded. I'll be back next week with Bible Bus Part 28. May everybody have a blessed week. May Jesus bless you. May you be at church on Sunday in person. Stop fearing. Jesus has got you. He'll protect you to the end till he comes back. The devil has a short time. Remember that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are. I'll be back.
Bible exists to take God's whole word to the whole world, and we invite you to stand with us with your faithful prayer and financial support. Where will God's word go today?
That was sponsored by Through the Bible Radio Network on 99.5 KKLA.
Hey, I am Katie Evans, and this has happened a couple times with this same friend. I won't call her out on air, but got a text from a friend that said, hey, I got you this book that I thought you would like. I was like, oh, sweet. I'm like, so sweet of you. Thank you. Like, she's got great taste in books, and whenever she recommends something, it never fails to impress me. And so I said, oh, that's so awesome. And then she's like, actually, I got to come clean. I was like, oh, okay, what is it? And she's like, I ordered this book because it sounded really interesting. And I was really excited to read it. And then after I ordered it, I was going through my bookshelf and realized I already owned it because a couple months ago I thought, hey, I should buy that book. So in her accidental buying of the same book twice a couple months apart, I now get a free book and we're going to read it together in like a little mini book club. But you know what? I can't say that I haven't done the same thing. And so listen, it's just... we love buying books. We don't always read them right away, which is the problem. But hey, good friends are always there to take an extra book off your hand, especially when they've got great taste in reading.
Morning, noon, and night. Always here for you.
I love KKLA. I listen to it all day long.
99.5 KKLA. Find hope here. KKLA's Thankful Thursday. Tell us why your pastor and the church staff should receive a free lunch. Submit your story at kkla.com/thankful. Then every Thursday, the KKLA Street Team will provide a pastor and his church staff with free lunch. Thankful Thursday is sponsored by Hope Cafe and Catering. Remember them for your parties and family get-togethers. And by America's Christian Credit Union, americaschristiancu.com/switch. One entry per week. Submit your entry now on the KKLA app or at kkla.com/thankful.
KKLA family, it's David James with a dear friend of mine, real life, Regina Pastore.
And David James.
And every Saturday night, 7:30 on Real Life, Regina Pastore. Gina, well, what's your hope for the show? What do we talk about?
We talk about the things that people don't like to talk about. That's what we talk about. We'll talk about the need to move forward after grief, being a mom during this COVID crisis. And we challenge and encourage you and discuss things like, what do you need to let go of?
And Gina, you know, having a strong, healthy, vibrant marriage is work. It doesn't mean we don't ever fight. Of course we fight, but do we fight in the right way? And with this lockdown and all forces vying to get our marriage destroyed, how do we live in the confidence of Jesus and not from a place of fear? Dr. Mark Baker from LaVie Counseling joins us. Real Life, Gina Pastore. It's this Saturday night and every Saturday night at 7:30 here on KKLA.
We hope you'll join us.
Most mortgage lenders charge a fee, sometimes up to a point and a half for pulling cash out of your home's equity. Those points are on your whole loan balance, not just the cash you get. For example, if your loan amount is $400,000, that's a $6,000 fee. For a limited time, Owning will waive this fee so qualified borrowers can get a cash out refi with absolutely no closing costs of any kind. Besides the usual no title, escrow, appraisal, etc., no fees for a cash out on a 30-year fixed mortgage. So if you're in process somewhere and paying fees, call 8332-OWNING or go to owning.com, where our rate and APR for a no cash out fee 30-year fixed mortgage is 2.75%. But hurry, the mortgage industry won't like this, so who knows when this special goes away. Call 8332-OWNING or go to owning.com.
NMLS 2611, licensed by the Department of Financial Protection and Innovation under the California Residential Mortgage Lending Act. Subject to credit approval, call 833-303-2160 for terms and conditions. Equal housing lender.
Listen on Odyssey.
and faith. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it, right? It's hard to be put out on a ledge, but sometimes you just gotta go for it. Deep breath, chin up. You got this. It's Danny Gokey.
Can't escape disappointment.
Coast 103.5 and Love Songs. Well, love this girl and love this song. This has got to be one of my favorites. Break My Heart, Dua Lipa on Coast 103.5.
I've always been the one to say.
Person, nobody is speaking second. Fluent in passive aggression, that's why you acting dismissive. Here, out for once will require you actually. Damn, your boy is back. I'ma turn my back, I just slapped him, so now. Is my back, say that damn Maybach bands with me in the back. When I was I still couldn't clean on my act. Whenever I tell the truth, you feel like you be back. That come on being attached, so how about we leave it at that?
You checking out that Liftoff show
every night
from 7 to midnight
on Power 106.
Hey, staring at your dress cause it's
cuando digo que no quiero amarte más es porque te amo.
Is the final score from Lumen Stadium in Seattle, where the Rams beat the Seahawks. They improved to 4-1. Sean McVay is now 16-5 following a loss in his NFL head coaching career. That makes 7 of 9 against Seattle with Sean McVay at the helm of the Rams. And Kirk, the Rams did not look like they had anything going at all offensively in the first half, and then in the second half, all of a sudden, they seemed to really find their groove.
Yeah, they found it, right? And I mean, we talked about it at halftime. That the Rams didn't play a
calendar I had that's marked July 15th. Because since there's no more you, there's no more anniversary. I'm so fed up with my thoughts of you and your memory, and how every song reminds me of what used to be. That's the reason I'm so sick of love songs, so tired of tears, so done with this. You are
off the radio?
Why can't I turn off the radio?
Why can't I turn off the radio?
The Wave. Wave.
Little friendly fire accident. Darius Williams had the game.
Three, two, one.